Thank you very much to both of our speakers. So now what I want to do is really just open the discussion up to have a chance to explore any of the issues that are of interest either to you or to the speakers. So does someone want to kick off with a difficult question that we can try and tackle? Someone must have something you particularly want to ask.
Horrendous questions for all of us.
It's not a question, it's a reflection really. I'm struck, although you obviously expose very extreme cases, I'm struck at how many similarities there are between what you raised and what we discussed in the previous session. And of course, I have not worked in the global south, so I just wanted to reflect on the parallels really. And if you could perhaps share your thoughts, if you attended the previous session, on what were the issues which you think are really similar, but maybe the responses are different. And on your last final presentation, I was really struck by all your discussion on conflict. Of course, it's very extreme, but I've started with other colleagues to work on London, and London is becoming very conflictual in terms of housing and planning issues, explosively so. People are not yet killing each other, but you know, we might get there very soon. And I'm at the moment doing a project looking at conflicts in Tottenham, which is very conflictual. And this raises all sorts of ethical questions, because on the one hand, you may work with community group being sympathetic to their plea, but in the framework of another project, a completely separate one, I have to maintain good relationship with Haringey Council. Some of our students, former students, work there and are doing their best, and some of my colleagues are working with some of the very developers that are also contested. So you find yourself in multiple rules by virtue of being in three or four different research projects or contact with former students or institutional activities, interacting with actors that you're trying to keep a good relationship with, but the three of them are actually in major conflicts. And that is generating for me personally a huge ethical question about how do I handle this? And I think it came a little bit in your final presentation, so I wanted to ask you if you could say more about this from the point of view of the researcher, that you need to keep in a way, in a good relationship with the public sector, with your community groups, with your private donors, with you know, your consultancy clients, and because we have the luxury and the challenge of being able to navigate all these worlds as academics at UCL. We can choose, and we do all of this in parallel, which generates issues.
Let's just start with that one, because I think there's plenty of discussion there. And do you want to start off just with a response?
Yeah. Don't know if I'm very much of help, because I haven't solved that myself. But in this case, particularly for me, it was very difficult. And because I actually, before researching this area, I work in that area for an NGO in that area. I volunteer a lot with local missionaries on quite active issues. Then I work for the UN Habitat, that actually is one of the UN agencies involved in that same project. And I develop a very close relationship with some of those civil servants. And at the same time, I don't think that these elites are just the bad guys. At the same time, the difficulties there is that, and when I came to the DPU with that research, I was trying to think again, how can I think about this co-production? With who am I aligning myself in what ways? And how can I transform this into action? And the ways I did was that there was the way I solved it ethically for me in a way was that there was a round table at some point in which all the ministries involved in this project were invited. And that time that I was asked to make a presentation. So instead of presenting that case that would be too contentious, I sort of built an hypothetical case in which I basically show the same kind of dynamics, saying normally happens this kind of things. If the land is just given to this minority, then they will develop because they have the money, but then the price will go up and you will have a huge gentrification, all these other people will go away. And let's remember, in this hypothetical project I'm talking about, the initial objective was about residents, and then externalizing the things, raised very interesting sort of discussion. And I saw myself, the other things is that there was a donor there, there was a bilateral donor. I was also the only person who could speak the languages of the other people. So in a way, I was used very much by so many actors, because at some point you are the one who knows actually the most about all the dynamics of what different people think. So within the ethical boundaries, I was in a way used as a sort of a way to make dialogue. And there was also turnover within the civil servants and other people. hospital sometimes, they were looking for, and in the UN, of course, so they were looking for me to know about the previous history. So some of the stuff I wrote and I had published was very helpful for some of the people. So you are used in ways that you try to make that ethical, but I wouldn't say I co-produce with any of these actors in particular, because I struggle to identify myself with a specific
So for us, we have no donors, and we're a charity. We're completely free, so we don't have any alliances. And like I said, I was trying to say that quite clearly as well, is if we don't have any major outputs, and therefore no donors, means we don't have a research question, which means we're going working alongside our partner. But also, because it's a light partnership, it means we are freer to be more nimble. And in, certainly in the Change by Design workshops, we enable quite different scales of engagement. So there is a group which does the policy and planning sort of in negotiations at a higher level to try and enable kind of understanding of entry points where potential slum upgrading might be allowed to understand that. I mean, I completely agree in terms of all the things you're saying, the power relations and stuff. So that's the answer to that one question. But the first question is, all the stuff which was talked about in the previous session is relevant. I didn't want to raise any of it. It's something we discuss all the time. At the moment, there is a massive surge in architectural university studios going out to developing countries and building buildings for poor people. And we have constantly fought against that, because that to us is the most unethical practice that you can potentially pursue. So therefore, we embrace a whole bunch of different ethical issues in terms of the way that we engage with communities and stuff like that. So I don't know if that really answers, but we are absolutely constantly discussing these things and the ideas of them. But at the same time, I mean, it's quite interesting. In India, the first workshop we ran in India, our local partner, Seeds India, is one of the biggest national NGOs in Seeds working in reconstruction after disasters and stuff like that. They used us so cleverly, and they knew they were using us, because they knew a whole bunch of Westerners arriving in the Himalayan region. We designed and built a temporary shelter, which was about sort of understanding the local resources, so that if there was an earthquake and a mudslide in that area, people would be able to sort of use this as a prototype. Big problems with all of that sort of stuff. But the fact that we did it on land which they could not get the local municipality to give them to get an extra classroom for this one. So they manipulated. We never knew this until we built it, and we laughed with us at the end. You guys, you don't have any idea how much I used you. And he does that intentionally. He knows that we're coming over, and because we're white people, he can manipulate the municipality. So you have to be, I think we've become more aware of that, because that was, I mean, good for him. He used that, and the school had an extra classroom there, and it's still standing. But bad for us, because we didn't know, and we probably should have designed a better structure. But so it's kind of, yeah, I mean, it's complex. It's really complex.
Which I was just thinking is pretty much the point I was going to make. In thinking about this panel and this session, one of the obvious thoughts is that there actually is nothing that I could say, this is why we need to talk about ethics in the Global South as opposed to ethics and research anywhere else. In the sense that there is no topic that doesn't occur in different places. There's not, the Global South isn't some sealed homogenous unit where everything happens the same way. Far from it. All of the experiences that were talked about in the last session and the previous sessions had many points that were pertinent, whether you're working in the South or the North. But there are elements which make it worth having the conversation nevertheless. One of them, perhaps, if I can draw some kind of common thread out of it, is the issue that perhaps even more, not differently, but even more than is the case in a situation where there is maybe more structure, more established institutional arrangements around things like research, we need to be guided in the work, the research we're doing, by principles and reflexive action. In the sense, we need to be constantly thinking about what we're doing, why we're doing it, and what the implications are for people. We cannot possibly separate ourselves from being active participants in some way in the processes that we're researching. Not just because people use us, but they certainly do that, but because the very process of trying to understand complicated social dynamics in a situation of informal housing or conflict or both involves trying to, well, the process of understanding means engaging in a way where you can't escape from the immediate issues of people will see you as taking sides, however hard you try not to. People will identify you with positions. People will want you to identify yourself with positions, political positions, that say that so-and-so is wrong or so-and-so is right. Sometimes they want to do that because they want to be able to attack your position, as well as wanting to be able to co-opt it. And you are a part of that political arrangement. You're not separate from it. You are not the same as it. I mean, I keep thinking of examples when both Melissa and Andrea were talking from my own experience, which illustrate very similar things in terms of the way my research matters in a wider political sense, or a wider, sometimes commercial, usually political, in terms of people want to know what I'm going to say so that they can either disagree with it or they can use it, take a line and say, look, someone's saying this, someone from UCL is saying this. A colleague from Germany recently got himself in quite a lot of trouble in amongst some Somali communities. He's researching on some of the same stuff as I am because he's just produced a book and made some very inopportune comments on Facebook about the way he identifies with a particular Somali clan and a Somali area. And by doing that, he has really undermined some very good research work that he's done. You would easily be able to find out who I'm talking about, but anonymity is probably the, at least the technicality at the moment. But it very clearly, and he's been, his words have been taken up by some of the people that he's identifying with in a way that they're trying to use it to achieve political advantage in a very conflictual situation in an area that is currently contested between three different groups of people. And he has manifestly made that situation worse by his intervention and by the stance he's taken. So it's not that he's not suggesting he's objective, he's far from doing that. It's that, in my opinion, he's done something which I think is not acknowledging the constraints of the position he needs to be working in, and where I think as researchers we need to be very, very, very careful about identifying with particular groups or particular positions, even while being aware that we will have those charges leveled against us and so on. That's enough, more than enough.
This is a question, it comes out of a comment by Melissa, but obviously is relevant in many things. There was this idea of assessing impact of the kind of work we've done. So we've been focusing quite heavily on the process of research, but you're talking about the legacy, what happens afterwards. And I was wondering if you wanted to expand on this one, that you mentioned it briefly. And I was also wondering whether, in some ways, whether the research team reflecting on their impacts, perhaps the wrong people to do it. You know, I mean, could that be, and could this be something more about some constructive thing whereby researchers could do this on a reciprocal basis that could be part of the research community would be ready to sort of look at these issues, perhaps in a more dispassionate and constructive light?
I mean, I guess the question for us would be maybe we need to ask the DPU how they measure their impact in the way, because they will have a similar issue. And you know, if you're not building a building which is easily measurable, other than whether it's used afterwards, how do you measure all the stuff that is potentially happening? And I mean, we get asked the question, so when we were in Nairobi, the team collaborated with UN Habitat and we were Moya Trust, who were very active. We get asked all the time, brilliant, you've done and made a nice report, so what do you know? Is the community consolidated for land? Are they building buildings, shacks? Have they managed to negotiate with the government to be able to get land tenure? And we cannot answer that. Number one, it was probably the most complicated community in Nairobi because they will never get to that because it was owned by the defensibles. I wasn't part of the process of negotiating which community we worked in. So, but it's a really difficult question because as architects, we are measured by our outputs, which are buildings. And when you work in this world, most of the time buildings are not the answer. It's many, many other different things. And then So what are the measurable outcomes and how to develop those? And as I said, I mean, we're a bunch of volunteers doing this at night. We have Google Hangouts as our meetings because we live all over the world, and that's at 10 o'clock at night often because that's the only time we can get together. So then how do you develop kind of flexible indicators for a program which is only 2 weeks long, and then you don't have the funding to go back to support that community group with their ongoing kind of deepened democracy, whatever you want to call it. But so it's really complex, and I mean, it's complex for UCL who have funding. We don't have funding, so therefore, which is a good thing because it means we're flexible, but it's about we are very limited in our capacity. So I don't know how we do that, but maybe it is a research, because maybe there is some master's students who could do it, or even undergraduate students who could only do something useful with their master's dissertation topics. I don't understand most of the time. How these questions could get posed to universities that students could actually do something which we could all use and actually get kind of take on board and start to use in the practice. Whatever the practice is, I mean, working with local community groups in this country, like the ladies were speaking in the last session, I mean, what an amazing opportunity. I could never do that at undergrad. I took my students to Durban. It was the most terrifying experience possible. I've never gone south again with undergraduates because it's terrifying. Most people's parents died of HIV/AIDS. What do you do as a second-year student sitting in a community, and you're supposed to design a building by the end of the year? It is just impossible. Therefore, yeah, I don't know. It's difficult.
Andrew, do you want to follow up?
No.
Another do I.
Andrew.
Yes. Oops. That's two.
I would like to ask maybe more for Melissa as well. So I'm not sure if it's specific to the Global South, but how does it work? How do you choose the community to go and work with? What is the work you do previous to going on site? What's the question? How do you engage the people, and do they always want to engage in the process? So what are the obstacles you find in this? So, because you were talking about, I think Andrew as well mentioned, about empowering the people to become involved in the process, but maybe sometimes they don't want to be involved. Also, how do you manage expectations? So you're there for 2 weeks, you work with all these beautiful models, and then you go away, and then what happens? Because obviously they are not the ones going to read the reports, I'm imagining. Maybe they are, but...
I think mostly the reports are written quite basic terms, except for the fundamental principles. Anyway, I'm sure we'll be praised. So the way we work with people, so like a lot of the partnerships that have evolved have come from DPU. So the last workshop in Cape Town was to develop an action group, which Karen spoke about earlier. And that was because Alex has been working with them, and he is an associate of ASFUK. So therefore, that partnership and that idea came so very strongly supported by the development planning unit. In Ecuador, Isis, who was doing her PhD at Westminster University, it came out of her research. So she was comparing the work that she did in Nairobi and the work that she was doing in Quito, and therefore she developed very strong partnership links with community-based groups in Quito, and she then developed the workshop from that. So she was a very important part of that negotiation process in Kenya. It came from another, he's not an associate, he's an expert affiliated to be part of the Change by Design team since 2009, the first workshop. He was working for UN Habitat. UN Habitat employees are not allowed to go to the slum, so it was the first time he went to a slum on the ASF workshop in Nairobi, which is unbelievable considering he's writing policy for slum upgrading processes. But anyway, but he negotiated very, very closely with the Pomoya Trust. He was there, he was living there, and then EC stayed afterwards to continue her research. There's a very strong link with researchers and academics. So this is something that actually makes us a very vulnerable organization, because if we lose all of those academics, we have no ties to those community groups. At the same time, perhaps we need to find other strategies to develop community-based organization cultures. How we talk to the participants before they get there, we don't. We tell them it's going to be a crazy hard 2 weeks, and they're going to work their socks off, and they're going to come back knackered, and they're going to need a week's leave afterwards, so it's all for 2 weeks leave from our particular. I mean, in Nairobi, we worked 8 o'clock in the morning to 12 o'clock at night every day, 2 solid weeks, and the leveraging those skills from those people. I know Cape Town was more rational, and you were picked out of the development action group's workshop at the 7.9, which is a good thing, actually. So I'm not saying that's a good thing, but you leverage the skills of all of those people who are mostly either Part 1 architects, Part 2 architects, PhDs, master's students, who have amazing amounts of skills and knowledge and expertise. We leave the models behind, the community groups keep those models. The idea is that those are then part of their workshop tools that they can continue to use if they continue to work, or hope they will continue to work with organizations. But I mean, as are you an architect?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, we work our socks off. That's one of the most amazing things about architects. We work so hard and we are so visual. And man, you give us a model to make and we make it 3 hours and it's looking fantastic. And that is such a, Alex sits there sometimes watching us, he's so amazed because he's a planner and it's just completely different to the way he works. So we use our skills as much as we can to do as much as we can in these 2 weeks. Have I answered all the questions?
Do you ever go back after 2 weeks? Do you ever do a return and see what happens in a year's time?
So Alex is going
to go back. So in the case of Dag, for example, I'm going back.
No, I'm just interested in, do they actually make use of models? Does it actually have an impact?
Exactly, this is my problem. We don't have any
assessment of the impact.
The issue of going back is really important. I don't think there's an easy answer to it, but at least at a university like this, I've made a quite conscious decision to keep trying to go back to the same place as much as I can, which limits, in academic terms, the ability to go become an expert on half a dozen other countries. But I think that's important ethically, because otherwise there's no way you can stitch together from the beginning some kind of plan where you're going to be able to go back and see what's happened afterwards. You can only do it if you do it on a pragmatic basis when the opportunity comes.
If I could just add to that, and I did allude to that in the previous session, I think there are lots of ways of going back. I don't know who was it who said so eloquently who wanted to talk about endings.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it was very eloquent.
Yeah.
And I think there is something about that, but actually, in the case of many of our work, there are lots of different ways to go back and for them to come to you. That's the thing. It's not just about going back. We try as much as we can to bring our partners here too. And that's really important for them, you know, to come here, to talk to students, to come to UCL, it's a huge issue for them to be able to feed back into the kind of networks that we take for granted. But for them, it's not automatic that they can do that. By providing them some space to write a paper, somebody raised that issue of publication. Many of them don't get the chance to publish. And so if you can take someone out of their really busy schedules, they're all working like crazy on the ground, and actually provide some space for people to write, which they really want to do, then that's another way of coming back. And it can go on and on and on. They can be partners in research. They can be part of a network, that if you're setting up a network in an area and you include them. So in a way, I think there's many, many varieties. I think the important thing is to recognize and respect what they offer. That's the most important thing, is the respect. And it may be that you won't work with someone for a couple of years, but then they'll come back to you in other ways. So there's lots of ways to do that.
It'll get to him in just a second. The guy behind you had a question.
Thank you. I think the example that Andrea gave about this conflicting situation in Kenya was very helpful, and also the points that we raised. The first one about not asking questions that may arise in conflict. And then the second one about the harm of publication. But I was wondering about something that is in between these two points, which is something that I always find very useful in field work, which is the research process of talking to people, like long conversations, for building your own knowledge. I mean, in a way, this is not a process of co-production of knowledge, because in a way you are producing your own knowledge as an initial process of research. And I've always found very useful kind of like approaching people and having kind of like an initial very long conversation, because you can identify which are the conflicts that may arise and which are the questions that you may not be able to ask. But I'm always wondering at the same time, and that's information that I won't use in my research and I won't publish, because there's some issues that could be sensible and also because I may not be asking for permission to publish something that she's saying, because it might be because they won't give it to me. So I'm always wondering, what are the limits of ethics? I mean, what are the ethical limits of these informal conversations you have during your fieldwork that you won't publish, you won't use in your research, but you really need to kind of like understand the context, understand which are the possible conflicts.
Okay. Now, we've only got a couple of minutes, so I'd like to take Ben's question as well, and then we can address both of them. Jane might now ask another question. But
yeah, I just had a couple of comments on this question of going back, having been involved in this one workshop at ASF, which was a real privilege. I think the fact that the project was set up with a partner that's really deeply embedded and been working for so long meant that it's not important that I go back, or actually most of the people in the group, but it's just it's part of this long-term engagement. That seems to be the important thing. And there's also a going back in terms of that. I was struck by how international that group of students that were doing that workshop were, and how they were going back and actually obviously quite transformed by the experience of doing the workshop. So that seemed to be quite important with the framework that you used. But I was wondering, in terms of this question about measuring impact, how it might link to the kinds of output that are produced as well, and whether there's a way of, or how you're thinking about sort of building comparative archive from what we're doing, and whether there could be some kind of peer review built into that process. It seems that those things could come together in quite an interesting way, and I feel that one of the things that's a tension between the kind of work we've been talking about this afternoon and the academic system is that participatory research, collaborative research, is not valued by the REF system, and so there's always this parallel course of outputs. You know, multiple authorship might be valued, but in terms of the kinds of output that are given, well, I guess it's quite subject specific, I'm probably generalizing, but it feels that that system is quite restrictive, and that anyway, we're quite unimaginative in terms of the range of outputs, and it's certainly something that might be of value to a community, might not necessarily be valued by the REF system. So it seems that those problems go together somehow.
Okay, thank you. Andrew, do you want to sort of take the first question first?
Yes, very brief answer to a very complex question. First one on that specific project, well, it was a very lucky project. It won't happen anymore in my life because I had the opportunity to move in and out of that settlement for 10 years in a way to research, including living in the city for 4 years, 18 months of which just dedicated to that research project. So that's quite unique in terms of being able to use those informal conversation and that sort of participant observation. I believe the informal conversation can be used as part of the research in a very ethical way, and that are definitely a very important method for me. One, there are so many conversations. Just one thing is that I now working at the DPU, I have got used to a less privileged position of having to deliver something, just going 2-3 weeks in a place and move back. That's the world of development, which we are part now. But there is a way, and I think the very important way is the one of introducing yourself since the beginning of the engagement as a researcher. And have, even in informal conversation setting, if you have a notebook, the person knows that what they are telling you, they are speaking with the researcher, and that's research. And I think that's very important. Sometimes I think that there has been a lot written about how unethical is sometimes, you know, to have those few pints and lose that sort of distinction. For me, it's very helpful to have a piece of paper and a pen in my hands, so I know they will tell, that they may not tell me certain things, but if I want to potentially use any of that conversation, they need to know that I am a researcher 24/7 in a way.
Yeah.
So that, and I think that's part of being ethical. If you don't do that, then I think sometimes I prefer not. Sometimes, of course, if you walk around with someone, it's much easier to just hide in that fact and then try to memorize arrival and write huge, field notes. But there is a lot of conversation that I think it's important to that if you want to use that information, the other person in a way has to give you that informed consent. It's not that because they sign it the time you interview them that if 3 days later they're talking to you, that's done. I mean, you have to constantly remind that you are a researcher.
Yeah, that's what I mean, but I cannot ask a person to sign me a consent if I'm having just a normal conversation with them.
No, but tell them, I'm a researcher, I'm here to research this in this community. Otherwise, I think there is an ethic issue.
Yes, but I think that's a great idea. We need to change the are already creative, and I know that the team would love to do really different types of creatives with outfits, which maybe like the urban campus here did so used all the time. Just had one of the facilitators from London last year, and so we do. It's just kind of finding the metrics, but also the thing with measuring impact, you have to set indicators. Indicators need to be flexible. They need to be set by the team. They need to be agreed with the community group. And so it's not just something which is an output at the end. We've got to somehow change the framework from the start. We need to start to say, well, actually, the impact is important. So, how are we going to engage in that? Measurable impact indicates blah blah blah. Whatever. I'm not trying to say they have to be key performance indicators blah blah blah. They need to be flexible. But what are they? I just don't know. And we need to sit down and have a brainstorm about it. So exactly. But I do think the outputs could reflect those more interestingly. That they could feed into.
Can I come back with just one thing that Ben said, which is the ref would have difficulty with this? I don't think you would. I think if you do it right, this kind of work is absolutely impactful. There's nothing in the rules of the system that would make it problematic any more than any piece of complicated work is problematic.
I was going to say that having been involved in the REF process, it did give us an output that we could use, and did, I think, in some cases, use quite creatively in the form of a case study. A case study gives a bit more latitude to develop some kind of story about the way that impact has been achieved, and could be coupled with maybe creative use of portfolios, which I think we experimented a little bit with. So there is some room there, I think, to actually do something a bit more creative with outputs. That said, of course, this is an academic environment in which the place of the revered place of the peer-reviewed journal article is still right at the top of the heap, and you know, books from publishers that we all know and love are vitally important as well, and so on and so on. So of course those still dominate the list of outputs. But I think there's room there to look for ways of talking about impact a little bit more creatively than maybe has been the case in the past. Anyway, there are many, many things that we haven't talked about which would be great to talk about. I think that the issue you touched on, effectively the issue of consent, which is something which is constantly something we have to bear in mind, especially if for example, we're working with people who might be illiterate, might not be able to sign or read something, or for whom the understanding of the process of research might be so substantially different from the one we assume they might have, or might assume they have, that actually the point of signing a consent form is meaningless anyway, where the idea that consent has to be informed, the informed nature of the consent is not conveyed by a signature on a bit of paper, where for some people signing a bit of paper carries with it an import which goes way beyond anything that the paper might say. So the idea of applying a signature, even if you can read the document and understand the document, is taken as being an implicit, you're signing up to something way bigger than anything that the researcher is talking about, because they don't trust the possible intentions of the researcher or the program or the funder or the whatever, whoever it is. All of those are important issues which relate to the question of consent. But we have to finish. So let's not talk about those anymore. Thank you very much.
Thank you. thank you so much, Melissa, Andrea, and Michael, for a fantastic last session. And great that you've produced the film as well, which is brilliant.